Scott Mills is here, and he's going to be live streaming a bunch of the day and some of the speakers. And then that will also be available afterwards. It'll be live stream, and it'll also be available afterwards that you can go back onto the site and be able to review something or share it with the other people. And I'll say now, if you like what is presented throughout the day today, or if you don't like, tell 10 people. And if you do like the day, tell 100 people. Because the word, our big thing is getting the word out there and getting information out to everyone who needs it. So we're going to, hopefully we have all of our IT stuff done here, and we're going to start to...
Laminate flooring.
So post-traumatic stress is what we drop the D in terms of, we don't necessarily, it is in the DSM as a disorder, but we don't necessarily like the use of that term, not that it's not a proper term under medical stuff, but today we call it post-traumatic stress as a journey, because it's kind of never ending, the loop cycle that you get into. We're gonna cover off fear, stigma, resilience, moral injury, some perceived injustice, sanctuary trauma, peer support, alternative programs, and some post-traumatic growth as well. And I'm going to address a disclaimer. There, throughout the day, there might be language by some of the presenters, and that might be the only language that they can utilize that actually gets the point across. So it's not necessarily meant to be to insult anyone. And there might be attempts at comedy throughout some of the presentations, but that's the way a lot of us that do suffer, that's the only way we can get through the day, is by adding a little bit of that, because it is a topic that's discomfort. If anyone is suffering or triggered or has any issues with what's being presented, come see me after that presentation. If you need to leave the room, there is a quiet room. You go out the doors there, turn to your right, and there's a boardroom on your left that the association has graciously offered, so that you can get into to have some quiet time. But please, if you are having something, don't leave without telling somebody, just so that we can make sure that you're okay. Right? We don't want anybody leaving and being in distress. So someday, operational stress injuries will be treated the same as a physical injury. And our belief is it might not happen in our lifetime, the people that are currently on the board and stuff, but for the next people behind us and in the next generation, there shouldn't be any difference between how one is treated and how one gets back into the workplace. Veterans Life Canada, we deal with active and retired members, sworn and civilian, in First Nations, Municipal, Provincial Police, and Corrections personnel. On our website, we deal with therapist listings, crisis links, and alternative sports across Canada. So we have therapists that are willing to be listed on there. We have the crisis links, the alternative sports, a lot of those you're going to be hearing about today. In terms of equine and all the different modalities. Our motto with Badge Life Canada is strength in numbers, and that's really important when you think about it, because the more people that stand up, speak out, and give strength to other people, we're allowed to empower other people, which is awesome.
I'm coming home.
Sorry. And I've got a short little video here that's gonna play. It's just gonna kind of tell a little bit of what Badge Life Canada has been doing. We participated in the 22 push-ups over 22 days. However, due to I was challenged by a lot of people, and I'm unfortunately with my hand and different things, I wasn't able to meet that challenge, but I had a lot of people step up for me. And this is just a kind of an overview of some of that and some of the things that we've been doing.
I'm coming home, I'm coming home, tell the world.
felt so strong, and that feeling like there's nothing that I can't try. And if you with me, put your hands high. Haven't lost a life before. And if you with me, put your hands high. Dreams of future, I want the best. I hear the tears of a clown. I hate that song. I always feel like they're talking to me when it comes on. Another day, another dawn. Another Keisha, nice to meet you, get the mad found love. What am I supposed to do when the club lights come on? It's easy to be puffed, but it's harder to be shown.
Hi, we're two children involved with Back to Lantana, an organization that deals with operational stress injury, PTSD.
With a face like my own, it says he wants to be like me when he's grown. Shit.
And suicide prevention for municipal, provincial, First Nations.
Another day, another dawn.
Professional personnel across Canada. This is a shout out to all the children and loved ones. Sisters, there is strength in numbers. We love you. See you tomorrow.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Sums up a little bit of what we've been doing in the last couple months. We've been extremely busy at Bachelor Life Canada. We have a lot of things going on. Two of the slides there had Theo Fleury. I don't know if everyone knows Theo. He was out in Newfoundland at a PTSD conference that we were at. And we were showing off our ink there together. One of the tattoos that he has is a frog. It's a tribal frog, and his motto for that is always forward, right? And frog doesn't go sideways, doesn't go backwards. If you ever watch a frog, it always goes forward. And with his trauma, that's what one of the things that's important to him. The other thing that I'll point out there is my in terms of resilience, my own family. My son that was speaking there, he's my youngest son, just been diagnosed with Asperger's and his own post-traumatic stress. And my daughter who's here today, we almost lost her at 2 weeks of age, and she has some health issues that she's dealing with for the rest of her life as a result of that. And my oldest daughter, who's my second oldest child, is doing a master's program at McGill now, and I took her down. We did a kind of a Thelma and Louise trip without the without the gangster crimes and the cliff at the end. But we stopped and we were going to leave after having supper to continue on our thing, and she wanted to talk, and she said that I was the most resilient person that she's ever met, and she talked about being a role model, and the years of me standing up and speaking out on behalf of people that suffer gave her the strength for her to come out and actually tell the world that she's gay, and that's pretty amazing that I was able to not only be insightful, hopefully for other people, but for your own children, they're able to learn a few of those things and go forward. So one of the things that we deal with is the work-life balance, and the question that we get asked quite a bit through Badge of Life Canada and through a lot of organizations in terms of management is whether your work life affects all other parts of your life. And some people they're holding on for a promotion or a different spot in the organization. They get to a crossroads, whether they're gonna put time into their family or put time into their job. And the goodbye part is generally what happens to your family situation. You choose different choices along the way, and as that in the end result is we have a lot of family issues, personal issues, and today the work your workplace doesn't take place in a vacuum. There's issues with promotion, discipline, behavior, attitude. You get home. There's family, emotional numbing, love, vulnerability, which is a big thing that we talk about a lot. And with regards to having the trauma, is the stigma, the shame, honor, and moral injury, which will be talked about throughout the day. So simply, your life is connected. You can't have emotions at home and have your brain turned on, and go to work and shut off the switch and have emotional numbing. Because generally what happens is emotional numbing takes over, and when you get home, you can't flip that switch on anymore and provide the love and happiness and support to your family members. So members end up getting onto a hamster wheel sort of thing, and they're running, and they find that every day becomes Groundhog Day, and their emotional numbing ends up taking over 24/7, and things like vulnerability, because we can't have vulnerability when we're working, because we can't show emotions when we're working, and that shuts down your love and your happiness, and they become distant memories. They become things that we say, I used to do that. I used to actually have those kind of things. So when we're in the boat, our water intake is overflows our capacity to bail, right? So we're bailing. Basically, you try to stay afloat, and unfortunately, sometimes the ship sinks, and then you end up, you don't have a boat anymore, you're treading water, or you're wearing a mask, you have the emotional numbing, and you're fighting to keep afloat. Addictions, we're gonna have a presentation on addictions today. Alcohol, prescription drugs, illicit drugs, gambling, sex, work, discipline issues, criminal conduct comes into play. The one thing that I, for me, is work. I was addicted to work, and it cost me a lot of things with my own family, which looking back is very disappointing. And discipline issues is not my issue, but it's an issue that is near and dear to my heart, because a lot of members, especially in policing, I can't speak for fire or EMS, but in policing, when all this happens and you start to unravel, you could have been the officer of the year 2 years ago, and all of a sudden you're facing police service act charges or criminal charges, and everybody wants to step away from you and leave you trying to tread water by yourself. And a lot of those times, if we look at the big picture, because we don't operate in a vacuum, your organization will say, well, you just had a bad marriage, or you just have a drinking problem, or you just have that. And a lot of times we need to look at why do I have that? and a lot of times it's because of some of the things that, that's happened in their employment. So that brings us up to that looping Wi-Fi message, and we seek out loneliness, avoidance, and we want to be left alone in isolation. So we end up being that hobo, and I know I have a few friends right now that were supervisors and different things, and they're couch surfing, and they're you know, they don't have a residence anymore. They're in their vehicle, living in their vehicle and stuff, and it's very sad. So who's there to help when we're suffering from those different issues? Well, there is help available. Professional therapists, crisis resources, and there's alternative programs that are gonna be discussed today. And it's just a matter of being able to find them. In some areas, such as you go north of the GTA or the Horseshoe, finding professional therapists alone is very difficult. Finding a medical doctor is very difficult for a lot of members, which is one of the first steps in trying to get help. So that's one of the reasons that at Badge Life Canada, we also talk about real heroes call for backup. And what that means is you don't necessarily have to be that hero that has a cape on and going to save the day for everything. Maybe the hero that actually says, I'm having issues here. I want to get myself back on course and be on the ship without any water. So we care, and as I say, there are strength in numbers with regards to that. You can be an individual, or you can be part of something bigger than yourself. So at Badge Life Canada, we have a pay it forward approach, so others can stay on the paved road, and they don't run off, hit the guardrail, bounce off a rock, hit a tree, and flip over into the lake, and their windows are open, and they sink to the bottom upside down. And everyone that's involved, we're a volunteer peer-led organization. All the money that we raise now is going towards is all put back into the organization in terms of our website. We're redesigning our website. We're getting charity status. We have our not-for-profit status already, but we're going into that route. And so we have a lot of things going on. You'll hear us talk about the hero's journey with Badge of Life Canada. And once again, it's not about the individual being more important than everybody else in this room. Everyone's a hero in your own journey. So when you're on that journey, there's a call to adventure, and that's in the abyss is on the bottom. So for Badge of Life Canada, I'll just quickly step down here for a second. And so for Badge of Life Canada, the logo, the badge is obviously for Badge of Life Canada. It was established in 2010. The leaf is for Canada. The thin blue line that goes through there is actually in policing. That's the thin blue line between good and evil. But for Badge of Life Canada, we're a helping hand, because the black that's behind there is the abyss that is called, which is here in the bottom of the hero's journey. And the abyss can be a lot of things. It can be the swamp. It can be a whole bunch of different things that members find themselves in. And you're spiraling under control. And that thin blue line is the hand that reaches out and brings people back, so that we're not losing members to suicide or losing members to with their employment or their marriages. And the abyss, we talk about that. There's a lot of your movies in that all follow the hero's journey pattern. Doesn't matter what it is in terms of all the big blockbusters, Lord of the Rings, all that. I use Star Wars, and the original Star Wars, where the abyss is the best is when Luke is with Yoda, and they're in the cave, and they go to the cave, and he's learning his Jedi apprentice, and he's going to go down in the cave, and Yoda says, they're talking away, and Luke says to him, "What's down there?" And Luke says, "Only what you bring with you." And then he does what most coppers would do. He starts to gear up and put his gun belt on with his laser and his lightsaber, and Yoda says to him, being the mentor of the helper, says, you will not need that there. And Luke doesn't really say much. He just kind of shrugs his shoulders, and he goes in anyways with that. He ends up coming up against Darth Vader. He draws first and starts a battle, which is really quick, and he ends up cutting off Darth Vader's head. But in the end, he actually sees that it's himself, right? So he's gone down in there, and when you're in the abyss, you're actually fighting a lot of the internal demons that are in your own soul or your spirit. So when you're in that abyss and you're floating, and the sharks are can be any of the things, an OSI, post-traumatic stress, suicide. There's lots of bucket work ahead, and what exactly does that look like? Well, these are my three keys to growth and moving forward. There's self-care, which is extremely important that we do very poorly. We do it great before we get on the job. We do it great for the first couple of years of the job, and then it goes totally out the window. Learning to be a warrior to your family, as opposed to being a warrior to your organization. Doesn't mean that you can't be loyal to your organization. Doesn't mean that you can't go and do a great job and put in 10 or 12 hours, whatever your shift is. But the energy that you put into your organization, you should be putting the same amount of energy into your family. And whether that's children, spouse, partner, whatever it is. And finding your tribe, which is, for me, is Badge Life Canada. It's no longer necessarily just policing. It's very specific in operational stress injuries and everything else that comes along with that, and helping those people so that they can move forward. So today we're going to be dealing with some professional speakers. We're also going to be talking some equine, some peer support, family, and different self-care things that we have on the agenda. And I would, just before I call up the first speaker of the day, I'm just going to point out a few people, and if I miss people, it's not necessarily intentional, just the way my brain works. But if I can just get you to stand so that for a second, so that people know who you are, and the board members, if you have something that you want addressed today or whatever, you can seek one of them out. You don't necessarily have to find me. Sid Gravel. And Gary Rubie. And Lynne Rusk. And I'd also like to have our senior advisor, Brad McKay. Very Brad? At the very back of the room there. Other people that are involved with Badge Life Canada, Brian and Kathy Noller, they're not here today. Scott Mills, who's at the very front here doing the IT, and he's live streaming a bunch of stuff, so he's not going to necessarily stand up. We have some volunteers here today. We have Judy Gravel, who's also going to be speaking about family at the back. We have Natalie Braun, who's at the back. Diane Barber, Nancy O'Neill, and Jenna Rusk, my daughter, is back there as well. We have, I'd like to do a shout out to 911, I've Got Your Back, Jill Foster and Sean Taylor, if you guys can stand up there for a second. We had a bunch of members sponsored, and they came forward with some money for that, and we appreciate of that, and also the fact that those people are here, and they're going to be getting some great information. Jason McKenzie from the Book of Open. Jason spoke at our June conference, and he's doing great work with his stuff. Natalie Harris, or paramedic Nat, is in the back. She's going to be speaking today as well. Dr. J, Jonathan Douglas, rocking it out, best dressed man in the room.
That's right. My life hack.
Dr. Jonathan is his last month as president of the Ontario Psychological Association, OPA, and Dr. Jonathan's also in private practice, a great friend to Badge Life Canada. And we have a board of directors, and we have research people and different things that are all involved with Badge Life Canada, but two doctors that are on our the medical advisory board that have been doing a lot of work for us. Dr. Beverly Bouffard, who spoke in June, isn't here today. She's in private practice and also a professor at U of T in York. And from CanH, Dr. Kathy Kamkar, and her, she's going to be listening today. And her birthday was yesterday, we missed it, and she turned 24, I think. So that was, and we have a Ottawa conference coming up on November 4th. We have some of the same speakers, but we have a whole list of other people that are in the Ottawa area. And one of the, we have a bunch of senior leaders that are in part of Badge Life Canada in terms of advisors. And Chief Parkinson from Cornwall Police is going to be there speaking in Ottawa for us. And I also like to do a shout out to Deputy Chief Tom Curry from York Regional, who just they just completed the ride to remember for from Elmer to OPC, and they did a video up and did a big shout out to Badge Life Canada, which was really awesome. So we appreciate all their efforts. So I'm going to turn it over to Gary Rubie, and Gary's going to be talking about fear in policing.
September, and it's a topic that a lot of people don't want to talk about or don't want to be affiliated with. Sponsors, fundraising, they don't want to be affiliated with that word, suicide. But our title could very aptly be switched to be suicide prevention, because that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to help those that are struggling in that dark abyss of pain and don't know how to get out by themselves. So I want to take a moment to remember those that have fallen to suicide in this past year, 2016, that are public service workers. I use that term because they developed their struggle because they were serving the public. And I think that's something that civilians often forget. They don't see what we do. They don't perhaps understand what we see and do within a day, yet alone in our careers. I also want this moment of silence to reflect on our founder, Peter Platt, who truly wanted to be here with us at one of our conferences this year at least, and hoping to be at the one in Ottawa next month. But unfortunately, he has fallen so far with his cancer struggle that he will not be with us much longer at all. In fact, he emailed me, texted me last night, "I'm on my way." So our thoughts are with him. Sid Gravel will be talking more about Peter later, so you'll get a little bit about the history and how important he is to us. And he's the one that brought most of us together as a family. And you can't do this struggle alone. And I want to thank all of you that walked in that door, because now you're part of our family, the Badge of Life Canada family. We're making the connection today. We welcome you to go around and make sure people know who you are. If you're struggling and you get emotional, you're a human being, so please allow that to occur here today. No judgments. So with no further ado, I'd like to just give a few moments silence, reflecting on those that have lost their way, and Peter that's on his final journey. I thank you, and here's Gary.
Between April and November 1984, seven police officers were murdered in Ontario. August 26th, 1984, Constable Dwayne Pukula attended a bogus break and enter call, and he was attacked, had his throat slashed, and was stabbed to death. And he became the first Peel Regional police officer to be murdered in the line of duty. August 27th, 1984, I jumped into my dad's car and waved goodbye to my parents here in Kitchener. And I drove into Peel Region and I started my first day on the Peel Regional Police. My third day on the police department was doing traffic point at a police officer's funeral. That day left such a profound impact, had such a profound impact and left an incredible impression upon me, because what followed was wasn't men and women crying, it was a celebration of the officer's life. And what happened was so foreign to me, to see a New York City police car being driven by an officer wearing a Toronto police shirt and a Peel police hat, and a Peel police car being driven by a York officer with a Toronto police hat, a Toronto police car being driven by a Waterloo officer with a London police hat. And there was this exchanging of uniforms and badges and the drinking. Remember the drinking? It was something that wasn't really foreign to me. It wasn't something that was new to me, in terms of there's a lot of men and women here that are struggling and they're suppressing a lot of emotion, because I was very accustomed to that as a young boy, suffering physical abuse and sexual abuse as a child. I knew that stuffing fear and stuffing emotions and hiding within myself was the way to protect myself. And that's what I saw. I went to 5 funerals in a very short period of time, and then it stopped. They called it the year of the killing. I went through my recruit training as a police officer at the Ontario Police College, and I spent 16 weeks in Aylmer. I came back to Peel. I spent a short time with a training officer, and then my third shift alone on a night shift, there was a heated call for a violent assault, and a description of a suspect was put over the radio, and I happened upon this guy running down the street, and ran him off the road and apprehended him, handcuffed him. I did a search and then placed him in the back seat of my car. Back in those days, you know, it was difficult to get on the radio and to try to get your call in. Everybody was stepping on each other, and I tried to radio in to say that I had the person in custody, and he was in my cruiser. And at that time, the dispatcher came over the air and said she had updated information about the suspect, and that he had committed this offense with a 14-inch knife, and that he probably still had the knife on him. And I thought, shit, I didn't find the knife. And I looked in my rearview mirror, and I didn't see him. And what he was doing was he was handcuffed behind his back, and he was pulling his handcuffs under his legs. And at that moment, I jumped out of my cruiser, and he had pulled a 14-inch knife out of his cowboy boot, pushed it through the back seat. So that became my first experience of a close call with an edged weapon. And when I opened the back door and drew down on him and dragged him out by his ponytail and disarmed him, I came clean with that information to my supervisors. And you know, back in those days, I was belittled. I was asked why I didn't. You know, you're a fucking pussy. Why didn't you shoot the guy? Why did you miss the search? If you ever get killed, I'm never coming to your fucking funeral. That was the kind of stuff I heard, and I thought, wow. Okay, well, I'm not a pussy, I'm not a rat, and I don't have fear. So I spent the next 25 years proving to people that I would do just about anything for the job, for the badge. And
catch the bad guy. I enjoyed hunting men, and I enjoyed hunting army men. I met with a lot of success early on in my career, and in 1987, my partner and I were working in a strip club with some known drug dealers. We watched a couple of men go into the washroom. We gave them a minute head and followed them in, and two men were in one stall, so we booted the door. My partner pulled the first guy, and I ran into the stall to grab the second guy, and you know, your thoughts and your instincts are to, you know, save the dope. He tried to flush and then pull the knife and you know, tried to kill me. So, you know, that kind of thing. I mean, it was a bloodbath in that small little area, and again, I was judged. Why didn't you push him back? Why didn't you draw it down? Why didn't you shoot him? And I thought, wow, you weren't there. I barely had time to save my own life. So, you know, that kind of stuff sits with you. And so I suppressed it again, and I drank, because that's what I was told to do. Let's go for a drink. It's all good. You'll be all right. You know, my career went along. I spent 19 years working in special service and working undercover. And you know, I had some close friends that were killed in the line of duty, and every time those things happened, I started to drink more. And in the early 90s, I went to see my doctor and told him that I was dealing with some sleep issues and suffering some anxiety and depression, and he put me on medications for that. I was challenged through those years, but you know, I wouldn't surrender. I wouldn't back down. I wouldn't let go of the hunt, and it was all about, you know, my reputation and honor. And through the most of the 90s, mid 90s to late 90s, I worked undercover drugs, and you know, we got involved with so many bad things that were, you know, undocumented, unreported, and I probably faced another half dozen close calls with guns and edge weapons that were just never reported. And so my drinking escalated, and my use of prescription drugs escalated, and my anxiety escalated, and my fear escalated, and I started to run. And I didn't know where I was running to. I didn't know what I was running from. At the end of the 90s, I left the drug unit. I went into the fraud bureau thinking that this was gonna save a marriage and save my life, and wouldn't be as crazy as working the undercover work that I was doing. And it was just a different pile of shit in a different corner, and nothing changed. So September 3rd, 2001, after about a year and a half of planning and orchestrating my departure, I left the police department after 18 years of service, and I joined State Farm Insurance, and I was gonna set up an insurance agency. And September 11th, 2001, while I was in the Scarborough offices of State Farm as a trainee agent, a couple of planes flew into some towers in New York City, and it felt like the whole world was under attack. It felt like I was under attack. And I had a friend who was in that building that perished, and something strange happened. I thought, you know, I'm not supposed to knock on doors and ask for insurance policy exchanges. I'm supposed to kick doors in. And so I went running back to policing and spent another 7 years. During that time period, our police service started an ICE unit, which was Internet Child Exploitation, and I was asked if I would become an online lure and to begin that portion of the unit with my undercover experience. I was a complete retard when it came to computers. I had no knowledge of how to work a computer except to pull the plug from a wall. That's how I turned it off most times. But they educated me, and I became a lure. I became a 12-year-old girl online, and you know, I'd seen a lot of things in my career, and I've witnessed and been involved in a lot of horrible things. And what I experienced working in the child pornography unit, just it just took everything to a whole new level. It just took it to a place that I couldn't even relate to anymore. And I thought, you know, just the sheer volume of torture that was happening to children, and I couldn't save them. You know, that's what I was supposed to do. I was there to help disabled people, women, seniors, children, people that couldn't, and most times weren't capable of defending themselves. That's what I signed up for. That's what I swore to do. And all I could see was these children's faces screaming. And, you know, I thought I had suffered night terrors and disturbed sleep and felt anxiety and pain in the early 90s. This just took it to a place that I wasn't capable of dealing with. And between 2007 and 2008, we started up another unit in the police service that I was with, and it was called a wellness unit. So they asked me if I would be a part of that unit as well. And for many years, I've been a member of the peer support team, and it was it seemed like a natural fit, because at the time I put a plug in the jug, and I was working somewhat a recovery program with relapses, and, you know, just trying to keep my world you know, in a manageable place. And so I did addiction referrals and peer support, and oddly enough, I was dealing with officers that were, very few actually spoke to me, but the odd one that did, that was dealing with any kind of trauma or emotional issues. Nobody actually said the words PTS back then. And in November of 2008, we had a lady call our dispatchers, our 911, and she was reporting a break-in as it was happening. And what followed was about an 18-minute recording of her brutal rape and murder. And then after a tower dump and a GPS on her phone, we were able to get officers to the address and apprehend the suspect and place him under arrest. But that audio tape I had to listen to assist with a debriefing for the officers that had attended that scene. And what followed a short time later in early December was what I thought was a nervous breakdown. I was sitting in my office, and I described it to people like somebody had put a 50-gallon metal drum over my head and started to hit it with an aluminum baseball bat. My ears started to ring. I started to cry. I was hyperventilating. I thought I was having a heart attack. I didn't know my phone was ringing. My supervisor, who was in the office beside me, came over and said, "Hey, didn't you hear your phone?" And then you see what was happening. And most of what followed was a bit of a blur. I went to my family doctor, and I was placed on disability. And then January of 2009, I went into the Homewood Health Center. And I want to give them a quick shout out, because they were, not only were they instrumental in saving my life, but they're here supporting us today, and not just financially, but with their staff. And they've been, you know, incredible to not just me, but many, many men and women who have suffered and struggled. I spent from January till April in Homewood. I went through a couple of programs, and it was while I was in there, I was diagnosed by three different doctors with post-traumatic stress. And I was told that it was severe and that it was career ending. And I had a hard time with that. My identity was my uniform, it was my badge, it was who I was. I've since learned that, you know, policing is what I did, it's not who I am. But at that time, it was like my whole world was taken away from me. They just pulled the rug out from under me. I really struggled with that. My union filed a WSIB claim on my behalf for post-traumatic stress, and it was immediately declined. which caused stress. I had my police service challenge those applications as well. So I felt, you know, why are you fucking with me? I got my hands dirty for you guys. I did all this shit, and you're throwing me under the bus. That's the thanks I'm getting. So in 2010, after my third appeal was declined, I was directed to sit on my living room floor by myself while in full-blown post-traumatic with over 500 police notebooks and create a document that was called A History of Trauma. So I went through my career one page at a time, one day at a time, one call at a time, one dead baby, one murder, one suicide at a time, and I had to create this document on my computer. So I was sitting by myself, re-traumatizing myself, and after a couple of months of putting together 43 pages and having my addictions spiral out of control, I set out to kill myself. Thankfully, I wasn't successful. I was arrested after a high-speed chase and was taken down by a few officers with shotguns, and I had a noose around my neck when I was arrested. And I went back into treatment that summer for an eight-week program, but I had resolved myself that the pain was too great, and once I got out of treatment, I was in an eight-week program in the Homewood again, and when I got out, I would end my life. And in October of 2010, I set out to do that again, and was again arrested, and this time I was incarcerated, and I was held. And there's no worse sound or feeling, you know? A judge banging on and saying, bail denied, you're a danger to society and you're a danger to yourself. Wow, I got 64 commendations. I have 64 letters of appreciation and commendations in my files. I have 8 awards, major awards. I'm a decorated officer. How did it all come to this? I'm a criminal. I'm locked up in Maplehurst in Milton. I'm segregated. I've been beaten up by the police. I feel shame. I was crippled with fear. I was crippled with anxiety. I was under the care of a psychiatrist who was a legal drug dealer who pushed a garbage bag of medications onto me. So I was basically taken off all those medications when I was incarcerated. And I suffered a number of seizures while I was in jail. When I finally made bail, I was placed under house arrest and placed in the care of my retired 80-year-old parents. Talk about humiliation and embarrassment. And that October, I went back into the Homewood, and I had a doctor that. I will definitely go on record as saying he saved my life. Dr. Harry Vedalego was my caregiver, and he'll be a speaker here today, as well as Wendy Wu, who was also one of my caregivers. And there's some staff here today as well that I have spoken to earlier today that were just hugely instrumental in me finding my way back out of the abyss. And I decided at that time that I would take my hero's journey, that I would come out and I would live. And I've been clean and sober since October 9th, 2010. With any luck, I'll have 6 years next week. And you know, I just keep moving forward. My train keeps rolling. You know, the biggest thing I learned during that time period was that all that shit that I was stuffing was also being stuffed with my fear. And when I stuffed my fear, I stuffed love, joy, happiness. I stuffed all the great emotions that I was, you know, taught as a little boy. And I didn't have any feeling, I was a void. So I had to learn to become vulnerable. Tough word, tough lesson. And when I became vulnerable, you know, I ended up allowing myself to feel fear. And when I was allowed to feel fear, and I was allowed to process my anxiety, process my pain, I started to feel really unusual things like love and joy and happiness. And I learned that you can't just stuff one emotion. When you stuff one thing like fear, you're stuffing everything. You don't isolate one emotion, you don't just stuff one thing. All my emotions were stuffed. I was just a big black hole. And it took a lot of years. I took that, the toughest journey for me was that 18 inches from my head to my heart. And I got real with myself. And in the end, for me, it was self-forgiveness. I wasn't a bad person, I did some bad things. But, you know, today I'm on a different path. A couple of years ago, I was approached by Peter Platt, and we had been communicating over a number of years, and probably since 2010 or 11, by email, about an organization that he was running with Sid Gravel. It was an online organization called Badge of Light Canada, and you know, he asked myself and Bill and Lynne and some other people to get involved with the organization to help other men and women who are struggling to move their recovery forward. And it was probably the greatest thing that I've ever done in my life. You know, I'm involved with so many great people, and I'm talking to people on a daily basis that you can't even imagine. Like when somebody cries and tells you that you've made a difference in their life, wow, like it's, there's no greater feeling in the world. You know, I was given an opportunity with Homewood. When I was in the last time, in October of 2010, I was challenged as to why I wasn't sharing, you know, my feelings and my emotions in my addiction recovery group. And I had shared with the doctors and the caregivers that I had shared, that I had opened up about my feelings and emotions, and that what happened was I traumatized a woman. She ran out of the room screaming, "Shut the fuck up." And I was traumatizing people by telling my story. I said, I can't share the stuff that I've been through in these rooms. And you know what, to Homewood's credit, they started a uniform professionals group. And it's a group for our Canadian soldiers, police officers, and corrections. And they invited me back to help co-facilitate that group. So every Monday I go into Homewood and I sit with these men and women, and I tell them, you know, I sat in your chair, you earned a seat. You don't have to tell me your bad stories, you don't have, like, this isn't war porn. You don't have to tell me what happened to you. I just know that you're struggling. You suffer what I suffer, emotional pain. And I just become a beacon of hope for these men and women. Show them I was here, and now I'm there. And it's, you know, the journey wasn't easy, but at the end of the day, it's my worst day in recovery is better than my best day in active addiction and in full-blown PTS. You know, I still suffer symptomatically with my feelings and emotions. They go off the dial. I'll tell my partner, it's coming on, I can feel it. When I first explained to her what it was, I said, you know, and part of the analogy, it's like when you're getting your period, you know it's coming on, and I just know it's coming on. I got some major bitch happening, and she got it, so she understood. I just say it's coming on, and she knows, because I start screaming, and I wake up sweating, and I have those things happen. But you know what, today it's all manageable. It's all manageable today, and I've got all these great people around me to help me. So, if I've left any message with anyone, I just hope that you understand that anybody that's in this room that's suffering and struggling, just know that there's a light and there's a door, and all you got to do is open it and walk through it, and just know that we're all here and we're all walking together. Thanks.
Opportunity to grab a coffee or whatever, but I'll get started anyway. Thank you very much to Bill and Badge of Life for inviting me to be here. I love this setup because if I really get nervous, I can just disappear behind the screen. Anyway, my name is Debbie Bodkin, and I was a police officer here in Waterloo Region for 24 years. And I'm basically a depression post-traumatic stress survivor. Consider myself very lucky because I've met a lot of people who have had a much rougher go than myself, so I'm very lucky that way. And I am just going to tell you my story, and I do get very passionate about it and can go, you know, sometimes I can talk for 3 hours, which I will not do today. But I may go a little quickly occasionally, but just so I can get through. There's so much I'd like to say and try it. I'm a teacher now, so I want to teach everything, that I may go a little bit quick, and nervousness might have something to do with that. Anyway, as I mentioned, I was a police officer here for 24 years. It was my ultimate dream career. I've wanted to be an officer since grade 9, for some reason. My uncle was an RCMP officer, so maybe that was a little bit of the interest, piqued my interest, and then I watched all the old TV shows like Police Woman running around in her high heels and a skirt, chasing bad guys and stuff, and decided I wanted to do that, but I don't like high heels. But I had an amazing career, and I was lucky enough to work in all the areas that I really had an interest in. And of course, you know, I had complaints about some things, like anybody could or does, but overall, it was my dream career, and I don't regret anything about it. But I did have some issues, that's the reason that I'm up here speaking. So why am I talking about this? Well, it took me a while, a few years after what I call my dark time, before I was ready to talk about it or tell anyone about it. But now I've taken a lot of training, done a lot of self-care, a lot of reading, so on, and I know a lot of officers who are also suffering who may not have come forward yet. So that's sort of my catalyst as to why I speak. The next slide, I just throw that warning up there because there may be some people whom you, some of the people in the room may know in the slide, and it may cause some emotions, because it does for me. But this is the real reason why I do my talk now. This year, and again, these statistics, we don't know if they're exactly accurate because there is still a stigma around suicide and mental health issues. But according to Tema Contra, this year so far, 48 first responders and 10 military personnel have died by suicide. Again, we know that that stigma is there, so a lot of people aren't going to come forward and want it to be spoken about that their family members have died by suicide. But myself personally, I know two people in those slides, which makes speaking very emotional, but it's my catalyst as to why I talk about it. So then I'm going to jump right into my story. And because I've been doing this talk now for a few years, I've tried to change it a million times. I really don't like talking about myself, but it's the only way I can lay out what happened to me is sort of kind of start at the beginning of my career a little bit. I've tried to jump right to the issues, but if you don't have the background, you don't know what caused the issues, sort of thing. So, I don't talk about it to brag about it because many people in this room have experienced, as we've just heard from Gary, have experienced just the same or more or similar incidents and so on, but again, it's just the way I can tell my story. So like any other police officer, I was trained to handle certain things, not trained so well to handle other things, mental illness, but my career consisted of patrol, as I mentioned, and then I went into detectives, did sexual assaults, and so on. But all the calls that you originally take in patrol, you sort of expect. They come with the job. Like the picture of the motorcycle reminds me of my first death notification, a gentleman who died in a crash on his motorcycle. And all these pictures are sort of reminders of certain incidents that I remember very, very clearly now, that I dealt with back in the, I was hired in 87, so say early 90s or late 80s, that I dealt with, went to the call, made the death notification, or pulled my gun for the first time, did all those calls
and did them well, I think, and wrote the notes in my notebook and moved on to the next call, because that's what we're trained to do. You do your job, and I should expect that I'm gonna, you know, deal with traffic accidents, with deaths, you know, our guns part of the job, and so on. So I did all that, and back then, did it, moved on, and had no issues with it. Carried on with my job. And then there's those horrific scenes that get ingrained in your brain, but again, you know, the one that sort of this mess of a scene reminds me of is getting called in the middle of the night to a toddler walking out in the snow in diapers and going to a home and finding the door open, mom passed out in bed with a guy, both drunk, feces in the crib, and just a mess of a scene. So we looked after the child, called Family and Children Services, and did what we're trained to do. Didn't have a problem with that. I mean, of course, at the time, it's emotional and it's horrific, but I made my notes, put the case together, moved on to the next call, like we're trained to do. There may be a few others in here who I blame part of it on the job, part of it that I married an asshole the first time around. I went through a divorce. And, you know, when I look back now, yeah, he didn't have all the traits that he should have had, but I had definitely changed over the 11 years that we had been together and I had been on the job. So not totally his fault, because I didn't recognize that I had changed. And I, you know, I don't think I'd become a bitch or anything really, but I definitely changed. So we just didn't work together anymore. I did take the opportunity to go to EAP because it's available. Of course, I parked many, many blocks away and we snuck in through the back door because it was right across from the police station in Kitchener. Didn't want anybody to know we were seeing a counselor. Obviously it didn't work and we departed ways. Also, like some in here, I maybe used alcohol appropriately now and then, you know, just a glass of wine after a shift, and not so appropriately other times when it was, you know, a couple bottles of wine after a shift. But that was how we dealt with things, and unfortunately is still accepted as a way to deal with things. We used to, on my platoon in uniform, we did our 7-night shift, and it was kind of a routine that after finishing the 7th night, we would drive over to one of the guys' house. He'd have the garage stocked with beer, and at 7 in the morning, we would get shit-faced. And it was kind of like washing the slate clean of what we dealt with the past 7 nights so that we can, you know, kind of clean the slate and could carry on with your 5 days off coming up and enjoy your family and friends and so on. Not really the way to deal with it, but it's what we did. And then I got promoted to sergeant, and I was given the opportunity to work in the homicide branch, which I was the first female, so I was really proud and excited and everything. And it was wonderful, you know, horrific work, but wonderful work, very challenging, and you know, the court cases, putting all the paperwork together, all that was part of it. I unfortunately had a few cases involving children, which is tough for anybody to swallow, but according to the senior guys who I worked with in homicide, I did a good job, did what we needed to do, and you know, moved on to the next case without a problem. During that time, our police service were sending officers overseas to help in Bosnia and Kosovo, and I went to Kosovo for 1 month and basically did my police job there, doing the same sort of homicide investigations, only it was genocide and war crimes, but it was going to autopsies like I did while I was in homicide and taking notes in regards to the death of the person and how they died and so on. Prior to going, we had to be interviewed by a psychologist, and apparently I passed with no problems. And when we returned, we had to be interviewed by the same psychologist. And again, I loved my work and I did my job well and didn't seem to carry any scars at that time. Came back from that trip, went back into homicide, on to the next case. And the next case was a young man who suffered from mental illness and ended up killing his father. Wasn't a, you know, the previous case that I really didn't go into, but that I had where a man, again, suffered from mental illness, killed his wife and his 4 children and then himself. And it was a horrific crime scene to go to. But did my job, did it well. Then this case came along and the investigation went well, And it was one day when I was sitting in one of our little cubbyhole project rooms, we call them. Small room, no windows, by myself, putting together the Crown brief, which is all the paperwork that has to go to court, which can take days on end. And I'd worked long hours and so on, but as I was sitting there putting this Crown brief together, I had this vision of the dancing baby you see on the slide there. And if anybody watched, it was an old TV show, Ally McBeal, there used to be this dancing baby who would run across the law firm floor. So it was one of the lawyers having a vision. But I was suddenly having this vision all by myself in there, and just kind of like a flash. Only the baby had a bullet hole in his head. And the youngest child in that family massacre was on a bed in diapers with a bullet hole in his head. So I remember, you know, of course thinking, what was that? And being pretty freaked out. But I just thought, okay, I've worked some long hours, I need to go home and get some rest and move past it, which I did. That my next case was not a horrific crime scene or anything like that, but it was a homicide, a gang swarming, one of those tough ones to solve, and it ended up taking 2 years to actually make arrests and so on. So during it, there was a lot of pressure from management, why we weren't, you know, figuring out who did it, pressure with the media because it had happened on a long weekend in a park here in the region, and the victim was non-white, so there was that racial, you're not solving it because he was a black man. All those pressures, on top of the fact of having 13 A personalities working in a cubbyhole, you know, together, long, long hours trying to solve this. And it was during that that I found myself spending way too much time in the women's washroom crying, just from exhaustion, you know, arguing with one of the other investigators, and just I couldn't keep my emotions in check like I'd been very good at doing. So it took a lot, and it was embarrassing and, you know, crushing to the little ego that I have to ask for a transfer out of homicide. But I just couldn't get myself, sort of had given up my personal life because we were working long hours, so I couldn't make it to the gym, I was starting to eat crappy, and my whole life was falling apart because of this case. And thankfully I realized that that's not worth it, that I needed to have a little more stable home life and work life balance kind of thing. So I did go and ask for a transfer, went back to uniform patrol, which was perfect because you know your schedule, you don't work as much overtime, no call outs and so on. So that definitely kind of got me back on an even keel, back looking after myself appropriately. Then I went into the intelligence branch. Again, it was sort of a real honor to be asked to go in there, and I was working with all the guys I'd worked with in the drug branch. So it was a lot of fun and a really cool place to work. While I was in there working, because of that trip to Kosovo, I'd been really sparked to want to do more overseas work. So I had been applying all along. And finally, I had the opportunity to go to Chad, Africa, and Sudan, Africa, investigating the genocide that was going on in Sudan. I just went for a couple weeks to Chad and then lived for 3 months in Darfur, Sudan, investigating, doing my police job, just in a totally different culture, different landscape, and so on. It was an amazing experience. You know, I met great people, and I would never change anything. But it definitely changed me, both for positive and some negative. But I came back to my intelligence job. And prior to this, throughout my career, I had always been extremely social, love having fun. You know, if the guys, majority guys I worked with, if the guys were going out for a party or going for a drink after work, I was there all the time. We had, in the intelligence branch, we had a big sort of open concept office, and we, you know, all worked hard, but we had fun, you know, joking with each other and doing what cops do, had a great time. You know, I had my desk booby-trapped, stuff like that, many times because I was the only female in there, but it was all in fun and I enjoyed it. But bit by bit, after I came back from that trip, nobody seemed to notice, or if they did, they didn't say anything. I started to change. Part of my job was to number informants, which is a very confidential part of work. And I had a little cubby hole of a room, which only I had the key and my boss had a key, where I had to do the informant numbering. And more, I felt more comfortable in there than I did out in the social setting with the guys. So I would go and do even my normal work, I would go into that room, so I was all by myself working. Because again, every once in a while, my emotions seemed to bubble up and I had to go into the washroom or into this room, bawl my eyes out, fix everything up, put my makeup back on, and put on the face and go back into work, go back out in the group to work. Most of the guys who I worked with were Tim Hortons fanatics and always went to Timmy's a couple times a day for a coffee just down the road. And suddenly I didn't want to go with them anymore. I didn't want to talk about work on break or all the time or whatever. I would go to Starbucks, get a coffee, and then go into chapters and hide in one of the aisles where I could sit in a chair and nobody would find me. And I sort of noticed I was doing it, but I just thought, I don't know, I was being different for a little while. But it got progressively worse and worse. And then it got to the point where, besides sort of segregating myself from everybody at work, I started doing it at home. And I went from going to the gym all the time, I was single at this time, so going out on blind dates, going to the movies with friends, I used to always take different classes and stuff like that. I was always active doing something. And bit by bit, I stopped doing that too. I started segregating myself at work in my little cubbyhole, and then would sometimes grab pizza on the way home or some other junk food, and I've always been a healthy eater, but grab junk food so that I didn't have to cook, go home, eat whatever crap I purchased, and then just be alone. Be alone and be miserable. And all these things started taking over my life. I was always tired, even though I wasn't exercising or doing anything more. I didn't want to talk to anybody, nobody at work, no, not my friends. The emails that the friends I'd met overseas, we used to keep in touch on email, didn't do that anymore. I had trouble concentrating, but I went into work every day. There was no way I was going to let on to anybody that it was falling apart. So I put on the brave face, sucked it up, the term we like to use, and went into work every day, partly because I'd been granted a leave of absence to do that overseas trip too, so I didn't want to spoil it for anybody else. So I kept going into work. I keep saying I'm going to go and pull my notebooks out from this time and see if I can see sort of a digression in my work, because I was lucky that I was doing a lot of stuff on my own, that was part of my portfolio, so nobody else would really notice if I wasn't, you know, holding my own. And I know I did keep working, but certainly likely not to the level that, you know, I prided myself in. So basically I had no interest in having fun anymore. And even if I tried to, like, put on a funny movie or a favorite movie or read something, I just couldn't get there. I was just depressed all the time. And then on top of the depression, then all those cases that I dealt with and I thought, you know, had put away, it was like I just did them all yesterday. And they were one after another swirling around in my head. You know, that the death notification, the family homicide, the people I'd met in Sudan and who unfortunately are still being killed by the president. So all that stuff, everything started coming back. And I like to say it was like I just read one too many books and the bookshelf came crashing down and every book opened up. So I kind of just kept going on like that until finally, I can't say what spurred me on, but I sat down at my kitchen table with a phone book. I thought, I'm not going back to EAP again because it's too close to work. It's in the same region. And started looking for psychologist ads. Not sure what I was looking for, but thankfully something in one of the ads piqued my interest and I phoned the woman, really nice lady, spoke on the phone, and I immediately sort of, you know, sometimes even on the phone you can tell if you like somebody or you don't. I liked her. So made an appointment. She was 40 minutes away from Waterloo region, so nobody should see me going to her home. Her office was in her home, so it wasn't a office with crazy walk-in here above the door or anything. So nobody would know that I'm seeing a counselor. And it was wonderful. As I said, she worked out of her home, really comfortable atmosphere, and within minutes, I trusted her and started bawling my eyes out. She basically just, you know, we did a little introduction, she handed me a box of Kleenex, and she said, when you're ready, tell me what's bothering you. And because as police officers, we're not supposed to let anything bother us, I couldn't tell another police officer. But this woman, Roz, was wonderful, and I basically poured my eyes out. Went every week for a while, then every other week, and the more I let out, the better I got. And some of the amazing things that she taught me, number one, which was like a huge weight off my shoulders, that it was normal, that everything I was feeling was normal, and I was a normal person just reacting to abnormal events. Those abnormal events that we in our job take as normal events, but we're not built to take them all on as normal because they aren't. I had never heard of post-traumatic stress at that time, and she explained that to me, all the different things that can come with it. The nightmares, the flashbacks. For me, the number one thing was the emotional numbing. I was just miserable all the time. I avoided talking to any other cops. My best friend was a police officer with another police service. Rarely talked to her. I had met her for lunch once prior to going to the counselor and put on the face so good that she didn't know anything was wrong with me. And when I left from that lunch break, I bawled my eyes out because I thought she would have figured it out that I was falling apart. But I was so good at covering it up, she didn't figure it out either. So I learned about what was going on with me and why. At that time, I had started dating my now husband, who is a gem and big shoulders, and he still to this day doesn't totally understand it, but he's certainly heard me speak about it many times. He came and met my counselor and she explains things to him, and he learned very quickly when just to stay out of my way, because sometimes I was a bitch and still can be occasionally. But for me, I consider myself very lucky because it wasn't so severe that I required medication. It was just getting it out, getting it off my shoulders. So for me, the things that work was yoga, and I'm really excited that the next person to speak is going to talk about yoga because it's wonderful, and if you haven't tried it, you need to. Starting to show my feelings at work a little bit, not bawling my eyes out or anything, but if I was having a miserable day, I would just say to the guys, you know what, I'm just going to work in the back room today because I'm a little bit grumpy. Or if I want to give them a giggle, you know, I'd say, it's that time of the month. And they say, oh, well, go ahead. So just starting to recognize my feelings and stop hiding them. I'd always loved photography, so I got back out and started taking photographs. I was born and raised a farm girl. I've always had a thing for cows. They have great eyelashes. And they're very attentive, and they are free counselors. And if you don't know cows very well, if you pull off the side of the road to where there's a field of cows, if you stand at the fence, they will all start coming slowly, and they will stand there and listen to you for as long as you want to talk. So I now live up in Kincardine, and I have to say there's a lot of cows in Bruce County that know a lot of secrets about me. But for me, again, it was just realizing that we can't pack our emotions away. You have to let them out. Otherwise, they bubble over. So I felt like I got things back together. I continued on in Intel, and then I asked for a transfer back to sexual assaults because that had always been my passion, and I really enjoyed working in there. Perhaps not the brightest thing to do, but I still thought I was the same person, and you know, my stamina was right back up. Went back in, and I did okay, but I know I got frustrated quicker, I got fatigued quicker. The cases definitely got to me more, or maybe it was just I was, you know, letting them. I was feeling things. And at one point, after working long hours on one case, I remember going into the locker room and just crying and taking some yoga breaths and trying to relax. We still had a couple hours of work to do. And it was at that time I recalled that when I had first started on the job, I don't know what year, but a police officer who I didn't know well, he had committed suicide in the men's locker room, which was right behind the wall where I was sitting. And I certainly sat there and thought, I can understand how you get there. I wasn't there, but I can understand how you get there if you don't seek the appropriate help. But I continued on, and then in 2010, while I was working in sexual assaults, one of my coworkers died by suicide. We weren't close. And I was his sergeant on his ship, so I was technically his supervisor. He had been transferred out before he killed himself. But after going through what I had gone through, I was crushed that I didn't realize. Damn it, I hate when I cry. I was crushed that I didn't realize how bad he was before it happened, and that I hadn't been numb. I hadn't been able to recognize it and be there for him. And unfortunately, I know from other officers who were very close to him and officers who went to the crime scene, actually, it happened at his home. It was dealt with poorly by management all the way down. It was just horribly handled, which I know there are still officers out there who still are bearing scars because of how poorly it was handled. But again, I continued on at work, and it wasn't until sometime after that, one day I was driving home from work, and I thought I was having a heart attack. I was having really bad chest pains and just couldn't get myself, you know, to breathe properly. Drove home to Guelph where I lived, pulled up in front of the emergency department and just sat there for a minute, and then I realized I'm not having a heart attack. I'm in great shape again. You know, I have an annual physical. It was totally just stress and anxiety and shit building up again. So lucky enough at that time, as I mentioned now, present husband, we were married, and he had got promoted and transferred up to Kincardine, and I was turning 50, so we discussed it, and I said, you know what, I think I have to change careers. I have to leave my dream career because I can't do it anymore. So retired early, 24 years, and don't regret that. You know, I regret it in that pride kind of way where I can't say I did my 30, but I did my 24. But I recognize the permanent changes in me. I don't have the same emotional stamina. I have what I call monkey brain. Sometimes things are good and I can concentrate, and sometimes I do 20 things in the house and I complete nothing. And some days I can sit and create my PowerPoint for these speeches. Some days I can't even open the computer. So I know things aren't perfect anymore. But now I do my speeches. I speak at the police college all the time. I've been lucky enough to literally travel across the country speaking at different police services about it. And I now teach a mental health first aid course, which is a 2-day great course created by the Mental Health Commission. So as a result of everything I learned, I now like to try and break down the myths that we live in the first responder world. And basically, we aren't Superman and we aren't Wonder Woman, and we all have feelings. And if you think you're going through your career and not being affected, you have your head in the sand, because we all are affected. It might not break you down, but it's going to change you, and you're going to need to reach out for help occasionally. And you just have to, it's totally proven that the more you know about operational stress injuries, it doesn't have to be post-traumatic stress, it could be depression. Depression is the most common mental illness in the world. And 1 in 3 people are gonna suffer a mental illness. So at least 1/3 of the people in this room, if you yourself haven't had a mental illness, somebody in your family or someone close to you has. So it's very common, and we need to know and understand everything about it, just as we understand physical ailments. When I first started, I knew that there was going to be stress in the job, but nobody really sat us down. I know it's changing now, thankfully, and they are discussing it, as to what critical incidents can cause you to be overwhelmed with what you feel, what you see, what you hear, what you smell at the scenes. And these are the top 10, and if you look at the last one, any overwhelming, distressing event. So it doesn't have to be a plane crash with hundreds killed. It could be your 50th car accident and there's a little boy in the back seat bleeding and he reminds you of your son and you fall apart. So it can be almost anything. It can occur from one incident or multiple incidents. And, you know, they say it seems to be less stigmatized when a veteran comes back from a 1 or 2 year term or whatever and suffers with a stress disorder or mental illness, whereas a police officer or first responder shouldn't. Well, that veteran experienced horrific things in those 2 years. We experienced horrific things over the course of sometimes 30 years or more. So it should be natural that we should know our mental illness or our mental health may suffer. And some of the causes, the risk on the job, sometimes it's management stuff that can just stress somebody out beyond the point of, you know, being able to handle it, public perceptions, and then the critical incidents. And it has been proven, and I'm sure we're going to hear more about it, that someone who has been diagnosed with post-traumatic stress, they have a physical brain injury that will likely last the rest of their life. So I've never had a CAT scan, but I know things aren't the same than the way they used to be. So I know I have something forever. And the reason we have so much difficulty stepping up and saying I'm falling apart is because we are the helpers. We are the rescue personality. We're the ones who are going in for the action. We're dedicated. There's somebody else who needs help more than we do, so we're not going to ask for help. We don't know how to say no when they ask you to do another overtime shift. We really don't know how to recognize our own personal mental wellness, and we have to change that. Because right now, even at our own risk, we'll deny all those things like I did and try and push through it and continue on and deny that you're falling apart because you don't want anybody to know, you don't want to lose out in promotion, you don't want to be seen as weak, and again, you assume there's other people who need help more than I do, so I just got to get through this on my own. So just reviewing some of the signs and symptoms, because as I said, when my coworker died by suicide, I wish I had had this list in front of me because I could have been checking everything off. Feeling disconnected, loss of energy, low enthusiasm, no longer engaging in normal activities, limited range of emotions, and don't feel like yourself. And basically what we have to look for in ourselves and others is when you just change. You're not the same person. I know of another officer who died by suicide. He went from an occasional runner to suddenly every day he was running huge distances. And that was the way he was trying to run away from his feelings, and it didn't work. So we really have to be cognizant of paying attention to ourselves and paying attention to others and getting more comfortable in stepping up to others who you work with and say, you're just not yourself anymore. You know, you want to talk? Do you need anything? Because sometimes, as I didn't initially, the person doesn't notice themselves all the changes. They need somebody to point it out to them. So thankfully, we are progressing, and there are new initiatives, and we're having conferences like this, which is great. I know we're going to hear a little bit of meditation too, which I now practice every morning, even if it's for 2 minutes. The monkey brain gets shut off, and it runs the way I want, even if it's for those 2 minutes. Again, yoga, there's a lot of new things out there that people are, well, not new things, they've been around forever, but first responders are actually stepping in and trying them. And just talking about it and doing little challenges, like Bill already mentioned, the 22 push-ups, it's sort of becoming viral, and, you know, sometimes guys just jump in because it's macho to do 22 push-ups, but if they actually think about, they're doing it for their mental health, for talking about mental health. There's now a course offered at Simon Fraser University. You can do it all online. That's specifically about first responder trauma, and just so you understand it better and can help others. So basically, we all have to just talk about it and change the culture where it's a hidden thing. Because we all go into work, and you know, if we know somebody has some type of cancer, we're gonna say, oh my gosh, how are things going? You know, if you ever need anything, let me know. Well, we need to do the same for somebody who you know is suffering depression or who has post-traumatic stress. You just have to be comfortable saying, I hear you're going through a bad time. If you need anything, let me know. And that's a huge thing. So we have to make use of the resources that are out there, like Badge of Life, Tema Contour. This book, Emotional Survivor for Law Enforcement, it's one of those books, either I don't remember if I was issued it or I bought it when I first started, never read it. After I fell apart, I read it and thought, why didn't I read this? So just little things out there. So look after each other, look after yourself, and thank you very much.